Think about Scott Pilgrim. Think about everything that comes to mind immediately just by saying the name. It can mean the film or the comic or any other adaptation of the character there is. Now you may think of fast-paced humor, manic visuals, a young and energetic perspective of the world, music, and just a fun, unique tone. This is what makes Scott Pilgrim. Now I recently went back and read the graphic novels because I love the film so much and I wanted to see how they differed from the film. I wanted to see if I could get anything more about the character out of it. As I read, I not only realized how similar and different the two adaptations were, but I realized how much Edgar Wright's style and personality matched this character as a whole. I also knew that Edgar Wright and Michael Bacall wrote the screenplay, as every graphic novel after the first one was being written. This affected how the novels turned out, but I started to think, would this film have worked with any other director or writer? Would the novels have turned out differently, changing the character as a whole? Some of the noticeable changes from the comics to the film were that Scott became what I like to call an Edgar Wright character. He's a misunderstood protagonist who has trouble dealing with his problems, and is usually put in situations where this is played off for comedic effect. Scott was not as nerdy in the comics, as he's known as one of the best fighters in Toronto, and he's a more forgetful person, which led to his downfall often. Whereas film Scott is nerdier, goofier, and is mostly just a safe choice for Ramona, as she felt need for change. Ramona's character also changed to be more about change in general, and this is shown in the cinematic tool of her hair changing as each act progresses. This still is part of the comics, but it is more embedded in her character in the film. In the comic, they're actually dating for about a year before Scott finishes off all the evil exes, and she genuinely seems to like him. But in the film, she is distant, cold, and more of an Edgar Wright secondary character to complement the misunderstood protagonist. Another major change is that the subspace that Ramona uses to travel through Scott's mind is a much larger aspect in the comics, but it's only mentioned once in the film. It's a large part about how Ramona ends up leaving Scott in the later part of the novels, and I would like to see this explored more, but I can see how they wouldn't have time to do this. There are also a myriad of other changes. I'll try to list off as many as I can, while not keeping it too long. The Pac-Man line was added into the film, which makes sense. It's such an Edgar Wright line, especially for this goofier Scott Pilgrim. For some reason, Stephen Still's full name is used. Scott's parents are mentioned. The dance game in the movie was used as more of a cinematic tool to show Knives and Scott's relationship and how it was growing apart. There's a lot of cut down on dialogue. There's Coke Zero product placement, which I didn't like at first, but later on I realized there is number symbolism for the X's, like Matthew Battelle holding up a 1, and then Todd wearing a number 3 on his shirt to signify he's the third X, and the 0 for Scott really signifies, I guess, that he's not an evil X. I hope that's intentional, because product placement sucks, but I know Edgar Wright and I trust in his filmmaking. This is probably intentional. Scott is known as the best fighter in province. I mentioned that before. Ramona is less reluctant to like Scott. She seems to genuinely like him a lot more in the comics. Lisa, which was an entire high school storyline, is completely dropped from the comics, and there's more Kim backstory involved in that. Lisa was a girl that wanted to date Scott in high school, and she ended up becoming a key player later on in the story for Scott and Ramona's issues, and we knew a lot more about Kim. She was a much more interesting character. We get some alone time with her and her roommates, and Scott found out who Lucas Lee was a lot sooner before he started fighting him, so he had time to prepare in advance. I thought this was an interesting aspect. I can see how they wouldn't have time in the movie. Again, a lot of these changes were to shorten the runtime, so it wasn't too long. And the entire Lucas Lee plot changed the entire fight. Like, it wasn't while he was filming anything, it wasn't in the winter, he didn't show up out of nowhere, Ramona wasn't there, Scott showed up with a few friends, it wasn't much of a fight, there was talking between, there was a break, but it ended up the same with the grinding down the skating rail. In the graphic novels, Ramona and Stacy are friends. Knives also notices Ramona from the library and notices that he cheated a lot sooner and she ends up attacking her a lot sooner than the final act. There's a lot more on Envy. She was in their band. We actually get to see the relationship. Scott's fight with Todd also has a night-long break. It ends up going to Honest Ed's, and then there's another break. There's a whole backstory with the drummer and Todd where Todd is cheating on Envy, which makes Envy end up fighting Todd, where she uses the Let's Both Be Girls lines that was used by Ramona in the film. Just about every character is fleshed out more, including Wallace, Steven Stills, Young Neil, Ramona and Envy fight, where she uses the hammer that she uses in the fight against Roxy. There are a lot more flashbacks that have a lot more backstory. Scott beating Todd was ex machina, as Todd intentionally drank something that was not vegan. Scott did not trick him. For some reason, Kim and Knives make out. There's continuing jokes about Scott not drinking and being very freaked out about people smoking, claiming it's evil. There's a backstory about the landlord of Wallace and Scott and how they get kicked out of their apartment, and, well, not kicked out, but Scott is forced to move out by Wallace, and then Scott ends up living with Ramona. Scott had a job. Knives' dad ends up trying to fight Scott, but then Scott earns his respect. Scott beat Roxy. In the movie, Edgar Wright uses his classic sense of humor to show Scott beat Roxy, and in the film, she is beat with the same weakness that Envy has in the comic, the back of her knee. And of course, in the film, Edgar Wright uses his classic sense of humor to finish her off with an orgasm. Scott's band records an album. When Scott had to fight the twins, he had to fight robots as their robotics experts, and it's kind of a totally different story where they use Kim to lure him in, and he ends up fighting them in private, not at a big concert. And the entire final book was not part of the story, except a few minor details, but this was inspiration from the film. Makes sense because it was written after the film started production. Now, all of these changes made sense for the adaptation in the cinema, and I agree with Edgar Wright and Michael Bacall because they could not have included all that into one film. I think the runtime is perfectly fine. If they wanted to add in anything else, they'd probably have to have sequels. I feel like anything else out of the story would have been too much and would have weighed it down. I think it was absolutely perfect in its pacing and how much content was in it. Something that is similar about both mediums is there's an attention to detail to telling the story. Brian Lee O'Malley has a lot of little details in his story, like the character descriptions that Edgar Wright ends up using. He has play-along sections that actually has the notes you can play on the guitar and sing along with the band, which I thought was really cool. There are fourth wall break jokes, there are subtle jokes, there's a lot of visual humor on a comic level, and Edgar Wright uses visual humor, but on a film level. He uses his signature energetic visual directing style, his subtle in the background clues that tell the story. Music is a major storyteller. He has the advantage because we actually listen to the music, and editing that forces the viewer to pay attention. For example, about his character detail, Edgar Wright wanted to, even though he made a lot of changes to the comics, he wanted to emulate the style of the comics a lot. He wanted the actors not to blink, which is fairly difficult. It may seem unnecessary, but it just shows how much he cared about capturing these characters in the comics. The average viewer may not notice this, but this just shows him going above and beyond what he was called to do. He also desperately wanted Zelda music in the film. He sent a letter to the creator of Zelda saying the music was like nursery rhymes of a generation and he needed it. He was granted the rights, and again, this is just a small part of the film, but it makes it more unique and adds a little bit more passion because he genuinely cared about this music by calling it that. Another aspect the two forms of media have is the humor. They're very visual heavy on different levels, and Edgar Wright is the perfect choice for visual comedy and visual care. His shots tell the story better than the script does often. Think of Baby Driver and how the editing matches the music, and how that creates a tone unlike anything we've ever seen, and how he makes mundane things exciting, like putting on headbands or putting away groceries. Think of Shaun of the Dead and how the visuals are jokes themselves half the time. Think of Hot Fuzz and how much we know about the character in the first few moments just by his energetic, fast-paced style. And all of these things from his other films that show his filmmaking are entirely what Scott Pilgrim vs. the World is to me. Exciting, fast, funny, unique, colorful. I can watch it many times to pick up on things I didn't notice before. Now, we can't talk about Scott Pilgrim without talking about the music. So yes, the same case can be made about Edgar Wright. We cannot talk about his films at all without talking about how vital the role of music is to the story. Baby Driver could not exist without that aspect of the character. It basically is the character's personality. In Shaun of the Dead and Hot Fuzz, music can often be used as comedic contrast to what's happening in the film. He carefully handpicks what music is used, and it's not just to be tone-setting or fun to the audience, but to actually breathe life into the story. He doesn't just pander to the audience and give us ear candy. It is excellent music, but it definitely fits what he's trying to convey and really builds off of that, giving us something we wouldn't have if it wasn't for the music. Scott's band and music is a major part of his character. I cannot see this film going well if this aspect was not encapsulated. Wright chose Michael Cera as his first choice, which I think was a great idea. Not only does he really add a new take on this character, as well as sticking true to it, but he knew how to play the bass, and he knew how to play it very well, apparently. But Wright had to teach the rest of the actors how to play their instruments, or get someone to, and this can be very time-consuming, but the band sounded exactly how it had to. He could have just gotten musicians to play the characters, but I trust Wright a lot to know what he's doing, and it turned out great, because we got great actors and great music. The sound goes hand in hand with the music, and if you pay attention, there's little to no silence in an Edgar Wright film. It builds the excitement and stimulates the ear, keeping us invested, really giving us no downtime to be bored, but yet we still can understand what's happening and have emotions seep in. Let's not forget about the cultural references. If there's a cultural referential director, it is definitely Edgar Wright. We can see this in Scott Pilgrim. He has Naruto hand signs, references to fighting games, as well as the big KO things that go along with that. He has references to Nintendo, to video games in general, and Zelda imagery, other subtle little things. Now, the writer also had to be in tune with this vision of this unique, beloved character. The writer also had to be in tune with this vision and make it what it was, since it was such a beloved and specific character to encapsulate. You couldn't have any writer doing this. Michael Bacall said that he wanted to write Scott Pilgrim because he felt strongly about his story and empathized with his characters, which is good to know that he wasn't just doing it for the money, since it was a popular character, but he really did love this story. He would later go on to write some of the better mainstream comedies, 21 and 22 Jump Street. So this style of drama and comedy fits, and it was carried on, as well as the fact that it was his own twist on an adaptation of a beloved piece of media that he seemed to truly care about in all three cases. Several lines from the scripts that were written by Wright and Bacall were used in later Scott Pilgrim comics, which shows that their writing was really accepted by the creator, to the fact that he would change the characters because of stuff they said, because he thought that they understood the characters so well. Another thing I'd like to mention is that Edgar Wright has been outspoken about cutting down on the need for unnecessary sequels. As I said before, we probably could have gotten more from Scott Pilgrim. We could have had like 2-3 films. I could see it being a trilogy easily, about 2 books per film, since there were 6 films. But he gave an example of The Matrix not needing a sequel because the story was complete. And although I do wish we could have seen the other storylines in the comics explored, I trust Wright and Bacall because they knew the story they wanted to tell and they did just that, and I think it's a fantastic story. Luckily, they did not try to create a cash grab franchise that would lose its edge and just pander to the fans, like The Matrix, as he said before. Wright has never made sequels for his most well-known films because they aren't needed. He provides closure and endings of his films that are satisfying, and the character doesn't really have much more room to grow. As the film is now, I definitely cannot see a sequel to that. But I'm just saying, if he could have originally decided to have sequels, I could see that happening, but he knew what he wanted to make, and it turned out well. Brian Lee O'Malley, after he wrote the first book, they offered to turn it into a film. He said he expected them to turn it into a full-on action comedy with some actor that he hated. Now, think about if this had happened. Think if any other director were to direct this and it had become what O'Malley had feared. It would just be a generic romance movie, similar to a Hallmark movie, but just add fighting and nothing else that makes it interesting. Think if it had boring visuals. It may have gotten the point across that it was about the baggage of dating, but it almost certainly wouldn't have been as effective. This style of film would not have been emulated by any other director I can think of, and that's not to say anyone else is lesser, but Edgar Wright truly was a perfect choice for this story, and no one else could have gotten so much style and originality in the way this beloved story was told and just fit the tone so well. Edgar Wright and Scott Pilgrim were definitely a match made in heaven.